Good morning. Welcome to all of you here. Hopefully we would have, and I am sure that we would have, a very fruitful session in which we would discuss something very important for Europe today, and not only for Europe. Let me introduce myself. I am Mihail Ionescu, that's my name. I am head of the Institute for Defense Policy here in Romania and Military History, which is under the aegis of the MOD, Ministry of Defense. I am part of this network, not like an institute, but like an individual. I had the pleasure to be together with Mr. Poch and the others being present here in Warsaw several weeks ago. So it's my pleasure to open up this meeting, this session, having like guest speakers, Mr. Béla Borsi-Kalman, who is our friend from Hungary. As a matter of fact, he was born in Romania, in Transylvania, in the Maramureș. Who didn't hear about Maramureș should have to go over there, because they would immediately understand what is going on in Central Europe, you know. And he would talk, he would present his views in Romanian. We have here a young student who would play the role of the translator. Hopefully, due to these technical issues, perhaps we would solve also the issue. We have Professor Stephen Wolf from Birmingham University from UK. Great Britain, UK. It's very difficult for myself now to understand how to... Okay, thank you. And for the moment, yeah. And of course, I would introduce each of the guest speakers prior to their taking the floor, with some highlighting some points from their curriculum vitae. Only to say that also Mr. Wolf is connected with the issue of the Romanian political space, I would say. He taught 10 years ago, I think, at the University of Bucharest. Also he was familiar, he was in a way very close to the process of the so-called Cossack Memorandum, namely one of the main attempts to solve the issue of Transnistria. You have heard about. I am using always when I am talking about Romanian names, we are saying Transnistria. In English, you would say that it's another way of saying it. So, everything is connected with the First World War, the centennial. But as a matter of fact, we are discussing here about the aftermath of the First World War, the consequences of the First World War, in a way about the consequences of the First World War, which shaped the world of today, and perhaps also the world, in a way, the world of tomorrow. We have heard yesterday, during the very fascinating panel for myself, a lot of things about the perception of the First World War in different societies within our region, East Central Europe, and from the war of, how to say, 30 years war up to the reunification war of Romania, as Romania is calling the First World War. There are a lot of perceptions, and also these kind of perceptions are shaping, how to say, the behavior and even political systems, in a way, of the societies in this region. Well, also, we would have to take into account the fact that the new generation has its own perception concerning the First World War. And for example, in my institute, I have witnessed such kind of things. As a matter of fact, we are amazed having a tradition, especially in military history, as you know, we have had a kind of traditional approach to the First World War, military operations and things like that, instilling, of course, some new ideas like army and society or the behind the front, the home front, I would say. But, of course, we have observed that the new generation has an entire new approach and perception to the First World War, and would be perhaps very interesting to talk about this kind of perception of the new generation. We would focus our panel on the minorities and cultural identities. It's a vast literature about these issues. Hopefully in our session we would be able to touch upon some very visible traits of these two connected topics in a way, trying to understanding what had happened in this region after the end of empires, I would say. Perhaps I would talk a little bit about this end of empires during the session. Well, not going too much in such kind of details, let me to introduce the first speaker, Mr. Borsi Kalman. I have had something here, yes. He graduated Ødvös University in 1973. He worked firstly for the National Library, he was also a translator. I would like to tell you something because I have found on the internet. I didn't know, but he translated almost all the most important Romanians, poets, not poets, novelists and also novelists, Romanian novelists, contemporary Romanian novelists, including Mircea Eliade, the name of our hall here, who is well known for his history of the literature. So, and he is talking Romanian better than myself, believe me. After that, he was professor at Ødvös University, working within the Romanian department of this university. And after that, he acquired the title of PhD in 2007, or am I right? Anyway, it's according to the internet, not okay. There are some surprises also for himself, you know. 84? That's why, and habilitated, he also was the head of the of a literature review, Romanian, Turkish, and Asia review. Am I right? Okay. And also he had diplomatic assignment. He was between 1990 and 1995 political counselor at the embassy of, with the embassy of Hungary in Bucharest. After that, he worked for another 4 years at the in Paris, at the Hungarian embassy in Paris. Between 2005 and 2011, he was the general director of a French think tank Thomas More Institute, both in Brussels and in Paris. His French is also like Romanian language. And he worked, he had a lot of books being published, so I am kindly inviting Mr. Borsi Kalman to take the floor. He would speak in Romanian and Vlad would translate. He is not a professional translator, but anyway, he would try to do it. Thank you, Vlad. Mr. Borsi, you have the floor.
Pentru această prezentare prea elogioasă, nu este adevărat, exagerează domnul Matei Ionescu. În orice caz, eu sunt produsul, hai să zicem așa, istoriei românești. Am învățat românește în nordul Transilvaniei.
Yes. Thank you for the kind introduction. I am the product of the Romanian educational system.
Am făcut grădinița românească, vecinii erau români, a fost foarte firesc ca să vorbesc românește de la vârsta de 4 ani vorbesc românește.
I was in a Romanian kindergarten, I speak Romanian since I was 4, my neighbors were Romanian.
Deci era foarte natural, după ce am părăsit România acum 56 de ani, când aveam 14 ani, ca să nu mă detașez de această cultură și am înțeles că este cultura mea. Adică, fără să vreau, am devenit un om, o ființă cu două culturi, cu două mentalități, dacă vreți, și m-a interesat și mă interesează și în continuare ce înseamnă raporturile româno-maghiare, dar nu numai în contextul nostru.
It was impossible for me to detach from this Romanian culture when I was 14, 56 years ago. It was an important part of me, and it helped me understand the relation between Romanian and Hungarian, the interconnectivity between Romanian and Hungarian cultures.
Deci, cu timpul am dezvoltat ceva care este, sau va fi, sau ar trebui să fie foarte important în înțelegerea raporturilor noastre foarte, foarte complicate de 1000 de ani, empatia. Adică eu am încercat și sper că am reușit într-un fel ca să înțeleg ce înseamnă a fi român, a fi român ardelean, a fi român moldovean, a fi român basarabian și hai să zicem, cum să fim români munteni și bucureșteni. Primul meu subiect.
Yes, apologies for the interruptions. I developed something very important, which is empathy. I understood what it is to be a Moldovan Romanian, a Muntenian Romanian, Transylvanian Romanian, Romanian from Bucharest, and so on. From Valachia, yeah.
Și primul meu subiect a fost imediat, am sărit în mare, cum a venit în apă. Raporturile emigrației maghiare din Valachia și Muntenia, după Revoluția din 1848-49, emigrația coșutistă, dacă vreți, cu elita românească. Și a trebuit să înțeleg că această elită este mult mai complicată decât din manualele sau cărțile istorice ungurești reies. Și am învățat...
I had to understand the Pashoptist emigration, the 1848 emigration of the Romanian elites.
Da. Și a trebuit să înțeleg că elita românească de atunci Nu este altceva, trebuie să sar, fiindcă nu avem timp pentru toate detaliile, este urmașul elitei fanariote, dar nu mai este grecească, este românească, dar cu toate finețele însușite pe parcurs și punând în folosul țelului principal de a crea ceva care nu a existat până atunci, care se numește România. Dumneavoastră românii?
The Romanian elite is the follower of the Fanariot elite, which was the Greek elite, but it's different from it in the way that its main goal was to this idea of the national unity of Romania.
Deci este o continuitate între aceste două elite, care nu este până acum, după părerea mea, prea bine elucidată încă. Deci mai trebuie să facem eforturi, mai ales din partea istoriografiei românești. În a doua parte, a trebuit să înțeleg eu, ca cunoscător al, hai să zicem, fenomenului românesc, că aspirația firească a românilor din Transilvania și de Besarabia, ca și a ungurilor de altfel față de Viena.
The continuity between the two elites has not clearly been established, and it's still a subject for debate. And the second issue which has to be understood is the aspiration of the Romanians from Transylvania and from Basarabia as well.
Se fac după același model, care este modelul francez importat din Paris, modelul Marii Revoluții Franțuzești din 1789 și încoace, care noi cu toții, poate și gruzienii, georgienii, cum să folosesc ca model până în zilele noastre, fără ca să-și dea seama că eventual, după 100 de ani, poate putem și 200 după Revoluția franceză, că poate nu era modelul cel mai potrivit pentru soluția problemelor noastre comune.
This aspiration towards the French model and perhaps the realization that it perhaps was not necessarily the best solution for all of our common goals.
Poate strămoșii noștri foarte inteligenți și pricepuți au greșit. Dar noi suntem într-o poziție foarte, foarte ușoară, fiindcă există un proverb unguresc, că poate și în românește există, nu mai știu cum se zice, că degeaba ești priceput după evenimentele, adică ar trebui să fii așa.
Perhaps our ancestors were wrong. And there is a saying in Hungarian, I believe, that says that it's useless to be an expert after the fact has already happened.
În orice caz, am înțeles un lucru important, poate sunt primul în istoriografia maghiară, că imajul românilor, în general, pentru unguri, pentru elita maghiară, era a românului din Transilvania. Adică țăranul român, umilit și amabil, drăguț, dar puțin înapoiat și așa mai departe. Adică țăranul român față de nobilul ungur. Bineînțeles, este schematic chestia asta, dar era așa.
I understood a very important thing during my studies is that the way that the Romanians saw the Hungarians was through their image of the let's say the Romanian peasants and their report to the with the Hungarian nobility in Transylvania. This was based on this relationship.
Și în realitate, E invers, fiindcă exponenții emigrației coșutiste aciuați în Valachia și Muntenia, pardon, în Muntenia și Moldova, nu-și dădeau seama că, de fapt, ei nu au o face cu reprezentanții țărănimii din Transilvania, ci cu o elită rafinată bizantină.
They didn't realize that they weren't actually dealing with a Transylvanian elite, but rather with a refined Byzantine elite.
Deci, de fapt, raporturile de forță erau invers. Numai că săracii unguri nu știau asta.
The report of the forces was the other way around. They had no idea that it was the other way around.
O mică paranteză, greșeala asta există și până în zilele noastre.
This is a mistake.
Greșeală capitală.
This is a mistake which we still see today.
În al doilea rând, fiindcă fără să fiu prea mândru, dar am scris și două monografii despre un complot al școlarilor, al liceenilor din Timișoara, chiar în 1919 și 20, care a ținut 7 luni, un complot cu totul uitat și din partea istoriografiei ungurești și din partea istoriografiei românești, și încă un lucru, documentele nu mai există. Au fost nimiciți.
I wrote about a forgotten event which happened during the 1990s and the 1919 and 1920, which was a plot by some high schoolers in Timișoara, and there are not necessarily any more documents about this anymore.
Și ce am înțeles din această poveste? Dintr-o parte, participanții complotului, adică, hai să zicem, elevii unguri, erau unguri după nume, dar nici totdeauna după nume. De fapt, erau șvab, sârb, era și un român între ei, maghiarizați, care luptau pentru ideea Ungariei mari.
The participants, which were mainly Hungarian students, but mostly by their names they were Schwabs, Serbian, and even Romanian, they fought for the idea of the greater Romania.
Deci au devenit peste noapte, timp de 50 de ani, fiindcă în Banat și în orașul Timișoara, procentul ungurilor pe la 1860 era 8-9%, nici 10%.
The percentage of the Hungarian population was somewhere around 8%, not even 10%.
Și la marele recensământ din 1910, care este valabil și până acum, fiindcă este o chestie destul de onestă, relativ onestă, dar știm că, cum suntem cu statistici. Aș putea să citez Churchill, că eu nu am încredere decât în statisticile pe care le falsific eu.
I only believe in the statistics that I myself falsify.
Deci, mă rog, după datele acestui recensământ, 54,4% dintre locuitorii Timișoarei, orașului Timișoara, se declarau unguri.
According to a census done in 1910, 54.5% of the residents of Timișoara declared themselves to be Hungarian.
Și era exact numărul general sau tot procentajul al Ungariei vechi cu privire la minoritățile etnice, adică 54,4 unguri și restul minorități. Deci, încă un lucru. Deci ar trebui să, pentru viitor, fiindcă sute de ani au trecut, România, dacă nu este atât de mare cum a fost în 1920, dar a rămas întreg, fără probleme, este poate singurul stat în zonă care nu a suferit când cu schimbările geostrategice din 1989-90 încoace. Deci asta e un fact împlinit, fait accompli. Deci și ungurii și românii, mai ales istoricii și sociologii, o să aibă foarte multă treabă, fiindcă trebuie să lăsăm la parte problema frontierelor, granițelor. Fiindcă asta ne duce nu numai în eroare, dar și la conflicte pe care trebuie să evităm cu orice preț.
Since then, 100 years have passed. Romania is one of the few countries in the region which have managed to avoid any geostrategic changes after 1989. And Romania and Hungary have a lot of work to do in order to leave behind them this problem, this issue of borders.
Deci, ar fi mai bine pentru viitor. Eu am împlinit și eu 70 de ani, adică eu sunt un om în vârstă, un bătrânel. Mă rog, adică la pragul bătrâneții, în orice caz, că să ne ocupăm mai pe îndelete cu modelurile noastre de formare a societății. Fiindcă în acești 50 de ani la Timișoara, ce s-a întâmplat? Eu, ca expert, pot să vorbesc despre asta. Modelul era modelul nobiliar unguresc, care este același ca al francezilor de odinioară.
It would be better for the future to deal with our own social models and to create our own social models, because for instance in Timișoara this social model was based on the French nobility model.
Deci este un miracol. Cum adică din 8-10% unguri în 50 de ani ajungem la 54,4%? Adică, și încă un gând, după Marea Unire, adică Mica Unire avea loc pe 24 ianuarie 1899. Era, după Petre Țuțea, era deja un miracol geostrategicește vorbind. S-ar putea că românii sunt copiii Dumnezeului, fiindcă miracolul acesta s-a întâmplat încă o dată și după un dezastru din 1916. Și acum am să citez un politician român foarte deștept și foarte instruit, Alexandru Vaida Voievod, care a vorbit despre anii 1918-1981, annus mirabilis, adică ani de miracol. Ardelean Jet-Beget, care vorbea mai bine ungurește decât parlamentarii unguri, fiindcă a citat pe de rost toată poezia lui Eminescu, nu pa Eminescu, Petőfi și așa mai departe, și a scris mai mult mai cizelat decât majoritatea parlamentarilor unguri. Bun. Da, gata, încă un gând.
Petre Țuțea was saying that the small union between Valahia and Moldova was a sort of miracle. And lo and behold, a few years later, there was another miracle with the addition of Transylvania. And Alexandru Voievod was saying that between 1818 and 1881, those were the, let's say, miracle years for Romania.
Noi, intelectuali unguri, mai ales istoricii, trebuie să acceptăm, fără gânduri ascunse, că acest fapt, adică crearea României mari, nu numai este un fapt istoric foarte important pentru români, dar este ceva în sine un lucru, adică o, un randament, adică o, un succes imens, istoricește vorbind. Dar dacă ești ungur, maghiar, din România sau ungur din Ungaria, este foarte greu să-l accepți, fiindcă succesul românilor din 1918-20 este eșecul total al imagologiei și al conștiinței naționale ungurești. De aceea am vorbit eu despre empatie, fiindcă empatia ar fi trebuit să fie și din partea românilor, românii ar fi trebuit să înțeleagă că un maghiar, un ungur, nu poate să fie prea fericit nici după 100 de ani la, mă rog, la festivitățile de celebrare a marelui act, care este fără nici doar și poate, adică este un fapt împlinit.
I was talking about empathy, and I believe that Romanians have to understand that this topic is still a very sensitive subject for Hungarians. And also Hungarian historians have to accept this fact, the fact of the union, as being important for the Romanians, but also in itself it's a huge historical success. And it's the success of the Romanians, but it is seen also as the failure of the Hungarian imagology.
Deci trebuie acceptat cum un fait accompli, adică lucrul făcut, dar și românilor le este foarte important ca să înțeleagă că nu e ușor să accepți ceva care este sfârșitul visurilor tale și începutul realizărilor rivalului istoric.
It is not easy to accept the end of your own dreams and the beginning of your rival's own ideals.
Deci, cei 100 de ani care va urma, după părerea mea, modesta mea părere, a trebuit să se facă prin cercetările amănunțite privind modelul nobiliar ungar, care este la rădăcina identității noastre, dar nici noi nu prea, noi ungurii din Ungaria, nu prea ne ocupăm, fiindcă nu prea știm cum, adică valorile și obiceiurile nobiliare, cum s-au amestecat cu valorile burghezești, adică ce este burghezia maghiară, de exemplu. Și acest lucru este și mai valabil, după părerea mea, pentru români care nici nu au început încă aceste cercetări și atrag atenția la un lucru care va fi cu foarte mare ecou și cu va fi foarte important într-o zi. Nimeni nu, adică cu excepția unei fete, Lidia Cotoveanu, nu s-a ocupat încă cum ar trebui de migrația necontenită a românilor din Balcani, macedo-românilor, până în zilele noastre. Atunci am înțeles, când am citit acest studiu nu de mult, în franceză a apărut la Paris, într-o revistă specială, că această migrație foarte, foarte naturală este la baza formării burgheziei românești, mai ales din orășelile din Valachia și la București. Și în Ardeal mai puțin, și în Moldova mai puțin, la Sibiu, asta, da, dar masiv, ca populație orășească, vorbim de orășelele din Muntenia și Oltenia. Și asta ar fi un secret. Gata, am și terminat. Da, pardon.
Um, uh, for the next 100 years, we should focus more on research regarding the Hungarian nobility model, how exactly the values of the Hungarian nobility model mixed with the Hungarian bourgeoisie, the values of the Hungarian bourgeoisie, because this topic hasn't really been dealt with, the topic of the migration of Romanians from the Balkan region. This natural migration basically is the basis for the formation of the Romanian bourgeoisie in Transylvania, in Ardal, in Bucharest, in small towns in Muntenia and Oltenia.
Și cu asta am și terminat, încă o viziune. Dacă lucrurile se vor produce cum se produc acum cu migrațiunea neînșirată și fără întrerupere din Siria și nu știu unde, din Pakistan și Afganistan, atunci s-ar putea că în 30 sau 50 de ani germanii din Germania și francezii din Franța vor deveni eventual o minoritate și atunci totul trebuie regândit și în felul acesta sau în cazul acesta pe care eu nu n-aș vrea, dar s-ar putea că să se întâmple, atunci toată povestea asta cu minoritățile naționale, cu al ungurilor sau, mă rog, aspirațiile lor spre autonomie, vor intra într-un tot altfel aspect. Mulțumesc pentru atenție.
If things keep going with the migration issue from the Middle East, the Germans and the French might become a minority, and this issue of the Hungarian minority in Romania will just blend in with the larger issue of minorities throughout Europe. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Mr. Borsi, as a Romanian, I would like to say after what you have said that it's an unbelievable situation that your works are not well known in Romania in a way. Because, for example, this study about the plot in Timișoara, and of course your conclusions at this study, could be very important for beginning the empathy which you have said that Romanians should show up to what had happened to Hungary during the First World War. It's unbelievable, fascinating for myself, again, I would like to tell you, that he is considering that what is today Romania, it's a kind of result of a Byzantine diplomacy. And in a way, I would like to remind you that one of the greatest historians in Romania, Nicolae Iorga, who was killed by the extreme right here, by the Iron Guard in 1940, wrote a book in 1935, I think, yes, Byzantes after Byzantes, taking into account the same idea. And beginning that, prior to the Fourth Crusade, in order to prove that what we are doing today in 1935 and what had happened during the medieval ages, and also the fact that beginning with the Fourth Crusade, they were well connected with the King Bela of Hungary, you know. I mean, the first Romanian Catholic kingdom in 1204. It's fascinating what you are saying. That's why, especially for the Romanians, I would like to, here in the audience, I would like to ask them to read his very short introduction to this issue, which is a study written in 2016, I think, about Fanariotism, Fanariot, and this political tendency in Romania. Thank you so much for your presentation here, which open up, I think, for the audience, especially for the Romanians here, giving food of thought, of course, and at the same time raising the issue, which please address them to Mr. Borsi here. Borsi, sorry. thank you, Vlad, also for your first, I think, experience. Like, yes, it's your first experience, like translator. My God, I will talk to your PhD guide because you are very good. Okay, thank you. Now, I would kindly invite to take the floor Professor Stephen Fall from UK. I am using UK. Yeah, it's you have heard that. Who is professor at the International Security at the University of Birmingham, a political scientist. He is specialist in the management of the contemporary security challenges. Already, Mr. Borsi raised at the end of his presentation a very important issue of international security of today. He said that perhaps if the migration from the south would continue, the Germans in Germany and the French in France would become a minority. So we would have to tackle with this problem of minority using other way of approaches. So I think that the organizers put both of them together, giving a very colorful, bunch of ideas to be discussed here. What I would like to tell you about Mr. Wolf is the fact that he has an expertise in Northern Ireland, the Balkans, Central and Eastern Europe. That would mean the most volatile region in Europe, and also Middle East. He wrote a lot of books, who were published in very prestigious publishing houses like the Oxford University Press. I would like to tell you that he has also a practical experience being involved in the settlement, well, not settlement, in the crisis management in different volatile regions and crises, like in Kosovo, Iraq, Sudan, Republic of Moldova, Daniela. He has been close to the Cossack memorandum process, Sri Lanka, Philippines, and the others. So we are kindly invite Mr. Wolf to share with us his own experience and ideas concerning our topic of today. You have the floor, please.
Thank you very much. So you could have summed up this very kind and long introduction that I'm somebody who knows almost nothing about a lot of places. And I'm a political scientist, so my use of history is very, very different and probably much less detail-oriented than what we have been treated to in the first presentation. And the only other introductory remark that I want to make is that I'm far less pessimistic about the fate of Germans and French in the near or even midterm future. So the way that I interpreted my brief for this panel was to look at minorities and cultural identities both in the aftermath of 1918 but also beyond. And given that I'm not a historian, I sort of have some sweeping statements about what happened in the past 100 years. But then I will use these in a much more sort of political, philosophical way to think about how we could use 1918 and the aftermath to hopefully build a slightly brighter future than we have seen over the past 100 years. So to begin with then, in my view, with the advent of nationalism in the late 18th century and arguably even before that, minorities and different cultural identities have come to be seen as problems, often standing in the way of grand state and nation building projects. Competing national narratives left very little room for difference, and rival nationalist claims to territories often left no room even for physical coexistence of majorities and minorities. Through the rise and fall of empires and multinational states, relationships between different ethnic communities, defined by differences in language, religion, customs, and so on, have at best been uneasy, and at worst, catastrophic. The inability and unwillingness of European states, their population, and elites alike to accommodate such differences over the past 100 years is sadly one of the defining features of the last century. From the Balkan Wars to the First and Second World Wars, and to the aftermath of the dissolution of the Soviet Union and the breakup of Yugoslavia, attempts to eliminate differences have predominated, including, as I'm sure you all know, forced population transfers, massacres, and acts of genocide. But despite these attempts to unmix populations, diversity remains a social fact across contemporary European states and society, and with it, of course, the challenge to manage it. This challenge, however, also presents an opportunity, in my view. And this opportunity is a deliberate choice to overcome bitter legacies of the past and to put efforts into a meaningful accommodation of minorities and their different cultural identities. Now, the question for the political scientists, of course, is what would such accommodation look like? And here I also think that a historical perspective is very useful, because from history we can learn what has worked and what hasn't worked. And political science then can enable us to understand why that might have been the case. As was already alluded to in the introduction, for most of my academic career I have studied ethnic conflicts and other types of civil war, their causes and consequences, and how they can be prevented and resolved. In practical terms, and this just repeats the fact that I have, for all my sins, been advising governments and international organizations on conflict settlements, from places very close, like Transnistria, to far further away in Iraq and Yemen. Much of this has been a frustrating exercise, and I can take no credit either in the emergence or the failure of the Cossack Memorandum in 2003. But on a more conceptual level, I would say that academics have made some very real progress on understanding why and how certain responses to diversity are better able to achieve sustainable accommodation and peaceful relations between different population groups. So for the past several years, I have worked with colleagues at the Global Center for Pluralism in Ottawa, Canada, developing a new approach to the shared global challenge of diversity. And as the name of the center gives away, this approach is pluralism. In our understanding, pluralism is an ethic of respect for diversity. It is a normative rather than an instrumental response to diversity. And we start with considering diversity as a potential asset rather than an automatic liability. That said, pluralist societies, where they do exist, are not accidents of history. They require decision and investment, as well as sustained political will by the institutions of a society and its people. While every country faces very different conditions of diversity, embedded in often unique historical and contemporary contexts, every pathway to pluralism begins with a deliberate choice. And that choice is to value rather than denigrate diversity. Such a decision, of course, has implications for policy. The goal becomes inclusion rather than exclusion, recognition rather than denial, all with the goal of fostering a society in which everyone belongs, and perhaps even more importantly, in which everyone feels they belong. Such an approach to diversity has two immediate political implications. First, pluralism is a constant process rather than a final end state that will simply and automatically reproduce itself without any ongoing effort. And second, for this process to succeed, it needs to be underpinned by both institutions and it needs to be embedded in a supportive culture. And both institutions and culture must make pluralism actively possible. So it's a choice and it's a constant active effort that is required. A society's treatment of diversity is shaped by both cultural and institutional responses. Habituated attitudes shape institutional choice, and in turn institutional actions can either reorient or reinforce cultural habits. You can think about this like the hardware and software of a computer. Both are needed to make the system run. When the institutional and cultural responses of a society align and orient towards inclusion, then they create the hardware and software of pluralism. Formal institutions of a society, constitutions, courts, legislatures, governments, and so on, define the legal and political spaces within which the members of a society act and interact. They can all contribute to pluralism in different but complementary ways, and what they do is recognize individuals as members of society. Formal recognition alone, while it is often the critical first step that needs to be taken, however, is not enough. True belonging can only be achieved once the norms of a society align with institutional recognition and reinforce perceptions of who is a legitimate and contributing member of this society. It is therefore not enough to simply recognize minorities with their different cultural identities in a legal or political sense. Given more than a century of often bitter and violent contestation over who belongs and who has what rights and which obligations, norms of belonging need to extend to shared historical and national narratives as much as they need to regulate the interaction among different ethnic groups in public and private spaces and the recognition of diversity in public life. Much of this, of course, sounds rather academic, and it probably is, at least to the extent that the principles of pluralism have not so far been embraced everywhere and by everyone. Yet we know very well from our own European history and more recent experiences that deciding against pluralism can have catastrophic consequences. Civil war and forced displacement, populism, radicalization, and violent extremism are unfortunately not only a phenomenon of a distant past that we have long and successfully left behind, or faraway places in Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. Sometimes it feels as if the lessons that can be learned from the past and present are being deliberately ignored, and the disastrous choice of deciding against pluralism is being repeated, despite the evidence that to do so has serious negative consequences for both individuals and societies, and despite the evidence that pluralism is actually a real possibility. So in that sense, when we look back over the past century, we can surely say that much has been achieved in Europe in the aftermath of two world wars and the collapse of communism. Inclusive citizenship based on the institutional recognition of diversity and embedded in a culture that fosters belonging has become a reality across many countries. It may not always be perfect, comprehensive, and all-embracing, but human and minority rights, civil liberties, political representation and participation, economic opportunities today extend to a much broader cross-section of our societies than ever before.
Did you now all miss the great thoughts that I shared with you? That would be disastrous. Anyway, so just to repeat then the last point. So I think a lot has been achieved, and what has been achieved may not always be perfect, comprehensive, all-embracing, but I also think we cannot deny that human and minority rights, civil liberties, political representation and participation, and economic opportunities today extend to a much broader cross-section of our societies than ever before. Yet at the same time, we must remember that such pluralism is a process, requiring constant institutional and cultural effort and the constant reaffirmation of the choice to value rather than denigrate diversity. Thus, we must not only remember 1918 for the horrors that it ended, but also for the opportunity it could have been but never was, the opportunity to create pluralistic societies in which minorities do not feel as second-class citizens, but as equal members who are recognized and belong, making society richer because diversity is valued as an asset and not feared as a threat. In this sense, remembering 1918 creates not only an opportunity not to repeat the wrong choices of the past century, but also an obligation to build on and intensify efforts to create pluralistic societies
in which minorities and majorities alike can strive and their members can reach their full potential as individuals. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor, for your absolutely very interesting presentation. A lot of ideas, talking about diversities, talking about lost opportunities after 1918. There are very important territories on which we would have to walk now, and I am inviting the audience for another 25 minutes questions, answers, and also comments. Please raise your hands and identify firstly. Please, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Watt. Thanks.
Professor Ivana Mitrashvili, Georgian National Museum, Georgia, Tbilisi. If you could help me, sir, to recollect the name of provincial town in the United Kingdom, particularly in England, where the first clashes took place between immigrants from Jamaica and West Indies and indigenous population. Later, that small provincial town turned into a sort of great location, a very popular musical festival, participated by young people from both sides. But today, now, I was told by one citizens of UK that situation still is under aggravation there. Is it true or not?
I have no idea. I have lived in the UK for 20 years. I'm not a British at all.
No, what about ongoing situation?
Oh, okay.
Because they just underlined that situation in that very town, which is the whereabout of a very popular musical festival, still, again, is aggravating. Thanks.
Since I don't know the town, I cannot give you sort of details on what's going on there today. What I can say is about a city like Birmingham, for example, which is super diverse, white British people are no longer the majority in Birmingham. They are still a plurality, but we have, it's below 50% of the total population. It's a very young city, so we have, I think, about 40% of the population below 40 years of age. And yes, there are tensions, but overall, I would say the UK in many ways, especially in big cities, has been quite successful in terms of managing diversity. Now, that's not to say that there aren't problems, that there aren't issues, that, I mean, we have tensions, we have occasionally violence, but in my view, I think there is, for all the trouble that we have with Brexit now, of course, breakfast is a whole different issue. I mean, being German and being treated to a full English breakfast, I mean, that's a larger challenge than diversity, I would say. But there are issues, but I think if we take those necessarily as a self-fulfilling prophecy and as a sort of forecast to the future, I mean, it becomes a self-defeating exercise. I think I find it much more useful to look at what are the actual successes of integration. And I mean, if you look back at sort of British history post World War II, I mean, such a large number of people have become reasonably well integrated in society. There is there are relatively few problems in the sense that you would say, well, there are first and second class citizens. Yes, they exist, but they are not divided on the basis of race, color, ethnicity. I mean, you simply have a very stratified society where you have rich and poor and increasingly fewer people in the middle. I think in that sense, it's not perfect, but there are some very good lessons to be learned from British integration efforts. I would say in the recent past, we have had problems. I mean, creating a hostile environment, as the now Prime Minister tasked the Home Office when she was in charge, that would not fit into what I would consider a response to pluralism. But then by the same token, we have the first Muslim mayor of Britain's capital, London. And I don't live in London, but what colleagues tell me is he's doing a pretty good job, and it's nicer to be governed by him than by Boris Johnson, who now, for better or worse, is in charge of Britain's foreign affairs.
Thank you. Now our friend from Germany, who served for 35 years in the German Bundestag, over there, Markus. We are waiting for a speech now.
Thank you very much, not so long. But I think it is important to prevent, to mix the question of migration today and the minority issues in the traditional way, because we have, if you see the migration today, usually not coming groups, which continue to be groups in the new settled country. We have individuals who would like to have a good life, and the question is there the integration and not the integration of groups which continue to be in their own identity in the new country. I think this is a quite different issue. That's why I think that was another issue which was raised. Coming back to the minority issue, I think we have, during the last century, a lot of developments which in many phases were really successful. My question to Mr. Wolf is, what do you think what we should do better on the European level? We have quite good, in my view, quite good regulations in the Lisbon Treaty, in the Charta of Grundwerte, basic values, but the implementation is more a problem. I think not the definition and not the level of law is a problem, but the implementation. And that's why I, for 10 years ago, I made a proposal that the European Union should establish a commissioner for minorities in order to bring people, bring that kind of population together to fight for their own rights, to work with the governments, and bring that together in, to improve the knowledge and the understanding of the problems of minorities. This is my point I wanted to raise. The second point is the relation between Hungary, which was raised yesterday yet, and now again, between Hungary and his neighbors, its neighbors. We have the Trianon consequences and trauma until today. But the question is what to do? What is the way? Because we know the policy of Orban, on the other hand, we have reactions in Romania, in Slovakia, in Serbia, and so on, and Ukraine. And the question is, what is your proposal from Romanian or from Slovakia to deal with that issue? And in my view, it would be very interesting to establish programs to bring them together. Because it can't be the solution to change borders again. It has to be the question how to deal with that history together. How bring people together from both sides and to establish programs to understand that history. On the other hand, to establish loyalties with that countries in which minorities are living. This seems to be a very important issue.
Thank you. Well, as a matter of fact, it's a question for you, Bella. It's about the international, sorry, the international, 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 the international,
No, Mr. Orban. Orban. You mentioned Mr. Orban. Yeah. Okay. Românește. I try to speak in Romanian because it's more familiar for me. Deci după Trianon. Ceea ce am spus până acum, drept o schiță numai, nu era o prelegere universitară, era tocmai cum am putea depăși clișeele moștenite din trecut. Și dacă nu ne lăsăm, nu depășim modelul acesta jacobin, etanasion francez, deci modelul stat-națiune modelul jacobin, atunci nu ajungem la nimica, adică continuăm ce am făcut până acum. Pentru asta am sugerat eu.
Thank you. What I have said so far is how to overcome the clichés of the past. If we do not manage to overcome this Jacobin nation-state model.
Deci trebuie să facem eforturi imense mentale, științifice, filozofice, cum am putea ajunge pentru a evita opoziția între minoritate și majoritate. Pentru aceasta am sugerat că ar trebui și românii și ungurii ca să-și elucideze situația lor aparte, adică cine sunt ungurii în tip de vedere, din punct de vedere al evoluției din Europa Occidentală, nu numai după modelul francez, adică cine suntem noi, ar trebui să știm mai bine ce înseamnă a fi ungur, ce înseamnă a fi român. Deci probleme de identitate. Și
we have to make a great mental effort to overcome these dichotomies, to figure out these particular identity issues, to answer the question, who are we? Who are we as Hungarians and who are we as Romanians?
Și încă un lucru, ca să înțelegeți mai bine la ce m-am gândit, există o carte editată în 1924 în maghiară, în limba maghiară. Autorul este un Mikes Imre și titlul cărții sale este Drumul Transilvaniei din Ungaria Mare în România Mare. Titlul cam ciudat, dar conținutul cărții este evident foarte, foarte perspicace, fiindcă nu spune altceva decât ungurii, adică elita nobiliară, elita nobiliară maghiară a încercat să-și înfăptuiască acest model francez, ne ținând seama de proporția etnică a regatului ungar, al vechii Ungariei.
To better understand this issue, there is a book which was edited in 1924 called the Road of Transylvania from Great Hungary to Great Romania, which has a strange title, but the contents accurately say that the Hungarian nobility tried to fulfill the role of the French model.
Și treaba nu mergea. S-a soldat cu o catastrofă imensă pentru această idee care a devenit o iluzie pentru maghiari și ungurii, intelectualitatea maghiară nu face altceva de 100 de ani că caută țapii spășitori, adică cine sunt responsabili pentru acest eșec. Cam așa aș putea să rezum situația actuală a intelectualității din Ungaria.
This didn't really work out. It was a catastrophe for the Hungarian intellectuals, which are still looking for scapegoats up until this day.
The basic answer is that since 100 years, the Hungarian intellectuals are not trying to understand what has happened. On the contrary, they are trying to find out who are the scapegoats for the historical event.
Și aș fi vrut să atrag atenția că pericolul acesta există, teoretic vorbind, fiindcă nu sunt un proroc, un profet, și pentru intelectualitatea, inteligența românească de azi. Noi nu avem altceva decât să vă propunem, noi, unguri, intelectuali unguri, ca să faceți atenție, adică să uitați ce s-a întâmplat cu noi, poate va fi un prost exemplu, adică yes. de a evita greșelile noastre. Noi altceva nu putem să vă propunem, fiindcă jocul s-a făcut, adică cărțile s-a făcut.
And he adds the following, that what I am saying for the Romanian colleagues, for the Romanian intellectual, that the same thing could happen to them and they would have the same answer. So we are asking them to take care and to follow our bad example of the Hungarian intellectuals who are trying to find out the scapegoats in order to find out ways to overcome it and to heal it, you know?
Fiindcă datele problemei nu prea s-au schimbat. Rusia există, tendințele, aspirații imperiale ale rușilor sunt aceleași ca acum 200 de ani. Nu știm până când va rămâne aici Statele Unite și cu US Army zonele noastre, dar rușii rămân. Și nu știu, și încă un lucru pe care românii știu foarte bine pe pielea lor, România, ce înseamnă România, adică făurirea României ca stat, era întotdeauna în ciuda, în pofida aspirații rusești. Deci dacă cineva dintre popoarele din sud-estul Europei cunosc tendințele rusești, sunt românii. Și asta trebuie să...
We still have the issue of Russian imperial aspirations, which are still available today. We don't know how long the US will stay in this region. And we have to remember the fact that the forging of Romania was despite Russian aspirations, and that there is no one else to better understand the Russian intentions in this region.
Dar se pare că românii nu-și dau seama că era o singură diplomație, o singură intelectualitate sau elită în Europa care nu a fost niciodată păcălită de români. Fiindcă e același spirit bizantin în care funcționează și diplomația și politica rusă. Trebuie ținută în evidență.
It seems that Romanians don't realize that there was one intellectual elite that was never misled. Yes, which was?
No, the Russian diplomacy is the only diplomacy with the Romanian elite
Și că aici mă refer la înțelepciunea românească, rușii nu uită, adică cine știe. Da. Rușii nu uită și au toate mijloacele ca să la un moment dat ca să intre în acțiune. Atât, dar s-ar putea că nu să fie așa. Dar asta este o chestie de teorie filozofică sau filozofia istoriei. Dacă România a avut bafta, hai să zic așa pe românește, adică norocul de a ieși două sau trei ori din constelațiile geostrategice cu succes, nimeni nu știe, numai poate Dumnezeu, dacă și a patra sau a cincea oară va fi la același lucru. Atât.
If Romania had the luck to come out successfully out of the Russian geostrategic machinations, so to say, we won't know if they will succeed the fourth or the fifth time to do it.
Și încă lucru pentru domnul profesor din Germania, dacă a menționat Orban Victor, adică toți politicienii unguri cu minte sănătoasă la ora actuală nu poate să facă altceva decât să protejeze, să conserve ce a rămas încă din minoritățile maghiare, din Slovacia, din România, din Ucraina și din Sârbia, fiindcă noi, ungurii, nu am câștigat practica. Suntem în căutarea remediei eșecului istoric. Deci un politician ungur să fie Orban Victor sau Antal Iuze sau cine știe cine, nu face altceva decât încearcă să protejeze ce a rămas din această evoluție de tip nobiliară și valorile culturale care sunt încă existente. Și încă o dată aș dori foarte mult ca să revenim cu toții vrând nevrând la modelul elvețian. Poate asta ar fi o soluție după 200 de ani de serii de trompări, cum se zice în franceză, adică de greșeli. Mulțumesc.
One more thing. All Hungarian politicians today are trying to protect what is left of Hungarian minorities in Romania and Slovakia. We Hungarians did not win the so-called game, and we are still trying to recover from it. And perhaps we should, all of us, try to look instead towards the Swiss model as a model of success.
Thank you, Vlad. The last question.
Okay. Hi, Karolina Lewestam. I am an opinion writer for a Polish daily, Dziennik Gazeta Prawna, and a lecturer at the University of Warsaw. I have a question for Professor Wolf. Thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting. So as far as I understand, you basically say that a response to conflict between the majority and the minority is our commitment to pluralism, which you define as ethics of respect for diversity. And you say that for it to work, it has to be sustained through double effort, institutional and cultural, in the same time. And my question is very simple. Do you believe it is possible, at least theoretically, that the differences in the form of life and goals between the minority and the majority would be so great that this effort would be... Yeah, it would somehow could fail. And what would be the marks of such difference?
Thank you. I'll come back to your question. I just want to start with the two questions that Mr. Meckel posed to me. Well, one was a question, one was a comment. The comment was that we shouldn't mix, if I understood it correctly, minorities and immigrants in our analysis. And I partly agree with that, and I partly disagree with that. I agree with it that, yes, very different origins. I mean, if you have lived in a place for whatever the last 2,000, 3,000 years, and if you have arrived in the last 3 weeks, very different. But again, I think we need to get some perspective there in two ways. One is that, I mean, the history of minorities, or what we consider today as minorities, is also rather diverse. Not every minority was the result of border shifts. A lot of minorities were the result of migration as well. They also, at some point, had just arrived 3 weeks ago. And I mean, the problems in the end are not very different. And the second reason why I think that, certainly from a political perspective, we shouldn't necessarily sort of draw these distinctions is because it creates even more division, if you want. If we then say, well, there is the majority, then there are minorities, and then there are minorities that we recognize because they have been here for a really long time. And then there are all those pesky newcomers that are just creating problems. You make it even more difficult to come to sort of an approach where you say, well, every individual human being is worthy, and every individual human being has at least the potential to contribute to society, to make it richer. So I think from that perspective, it would be very important for me not to sort of draw these distinctions too strongly and thereby create even more division in society. And I haven't really followed German politics that much, but I mean, in Britain, I mean, the immigration debate is very much at the heart of the whole Brexit disaster, and it's based on a lot of completely wrong perceptions. And these wrong perceptions are created precisely because of the idea that, well, there are differences, and you can be European, but you still don't belong, and you are just a newcomer, and you just sort of whatever abuse the NHS and stuff like that. So I think from that perspective, there is a real problem. I think if we take this approach that says, well, individuals have first of all to be classified in terms of how long they have lived in a particular place and what their connection is. Now the question that you asked, what to do better at the European level? Well, there's two things. On the one hand, I think it's really not the problem of the European level. It's really everything that happens below, in the sense that we have great laws, they are just not being implemented. You're absolutely right about this. And it really trickles down from the national to whatever, if we have a federal system in particular countries, all the way down to local government. I mean, if people just look for and find ways how they can not sort of implement equality legislation, non-discrimination legislation, of course that's possible. And I mean, people are very inventive in that way. And I think part of the problem here, again, is that there is a, it's a mindset. It's not the laws, it's not the institutions, it's the culture. And these cultural changes take a really, really long time. And I think the problem is that, and I see that in myself, sometimes, oh, I just want to give up. Why bother? I mean, if people just can't see what I see, then let's leave them alone, let's move to a little island or something like that. But then, of course, you get exactly what we have right now, populism, elites detached, Brexit, Trump, I mean, RFD, you name it. So I think there is a real obligation here in the sense that we do not disengage and that we push this more inclusive narrative and really, I mean, make it fact-based. I mean, the contribution of immigrants to the UK economy, both after the dissolution of the empire and after 2004, after 2007, is immeasurable. Now all the nurses and doctors from Eastern Europe are leaving and the health system is at the brink of collapse. I mean, hospitals are literally closing. general practitioners' offices, especially in rural areas, but there's nobody there. So you can come knocking, and then there is the British receptionist, but she has no doctor to call on, no nurse to draw your blood or anything. So it's this idea that sort of that people who are not born in the UK do not contribute. That has created a lot of these problems. Now the other issue at the European level, of course, is that, I mean, even I, as a committed European, find it very difficult to see how somebody like Mr. Juncker or Mr. Barroso or whoever Mr. Prodi came before him actually really represents a kind of Europeanness, a kind of European identity that I could identify with. I mean, we have basically old white men, and I mean, look at this panel, it's the same. I mean, look at the program, I've just done a head count. Of the 23 panelists that you have managed to find 4 women. That's not exactly the kind of pluralism that I have in mind. I mean, it's pluralism in that sense also is broader than just thinking about minorities. It's thinking about properly representing and creating opportunities for the entire spectrum of demographic differences that we might have. I mean, age, if it wasn't for our very gifted and capable translator, I mean, our average age here would easily be above 50, probably even higher than that. Again, I mean, that's not representative. I mean, we remember things very differently. I mean, my colleague to the right here and I, we actually spoke a little bit of Russian before because we both learned it in school. Now, that's not an experience that I think any of my students, any of your students here have now. So I think in that sense, the whole issue of being pluralistic really needs to start at the top. And currently, the European Commission, I would argue the European Parliament, without being able to give you lots of hard facts and statistics about this, is not representative of European society. And that's part of the reason why you get this detachment, and why people simply think, well, things that are being produced in Brussels are not worth looking at, not worth implementing, because they don't necessarily see visually how the people that make these decisions or somehow look like them, maybe feel like them, maybe think like them. So that has nothing to do with how good these laws might be in the end. If you don't feel they have been made by people that literally represent you, it's very difficult to get sort of to get this translated down to the lowest level of where they then need to be implemented. Now, finally, your question, absolutely. And I also, I mean, one of the things that I, in the end, decided not to mention in my talk is, I mean, there are limits to pluralism. So, I mean, there is sort of, if you want, I mean, you have to draw the line somewhere. So all of the negative effects that I see as sort of results of not having a pluralistic approach to managing diversity, I mean, these are also the borders where pluralism stops. I mean, it's not possible in my view, and I think this is something that is shared across the board with my colleagues in Canada at the Global Center for Pluralism. You cannot accommodate violent extremism. You cannot accommodate views that sort of want to, again, impose identities, impose a particular, whether it's a way of life, whether it's a religious belief, whether it's some ideological doctrine, because that's fundamentally contrary to pluralism. I mean, pluralism is about recognizing and respecting diversity, but not respecting a kind of worldview that then would deny and undermine that very principle. So yes, absolutely, there are limits. And I always make myself very unpopular when I go to sort of minority-led conferences and workshops where I say, well, it's a two-way street. I mean, we expect majorities to accommodate minorities, but by the same token, minorities also need to play an active role in this. And just to finish on an anecdote, I mean, I have worked for many, many years, longer than I sometimes wish to remember, in Moldova, and there's obviously the Transnistrian problem, but then there's also the issue with Gagauzia, which is a sort of small patchwork of territories in the south, and they have well, they have an autonomy deal since 1995, and there hasn't been violence, and it's been going well. So I mean, as things go in Moldova, but part of the problem there is over time, people literally are no longer able to speak to each other. Because there has been very little effort in Gagauzia to actually learn Moldovan, or as some people might say, Romanian. So they speak Gagauzian and they speak Russian. But you now also have a new elite growing up in Chisinau, where Russian is not exactly a lingua franca anymore. So literally within one country, you now head towards a situation where parts of the country cannot communicate anymore with each other. And I think in that sense, if we genuinely are talking about enabling people to make a contribution to society, to be recognized, to belong and to feel that they belong, I mean, everybody needs to make an effort. It cannot just be majorities asking minorities to assimilate or minorities saying, well, you have to accommodate more. So, and again, I think this is sort of the idea of having a national narrative, not sort of in the ethnic, cultural, national sense, but rather sort of in a broader civic sense, where everybody really sort of is part of the nation and recognizes that they have both rights and obligations, and that everybody is put in a position where they can actually fulfill and enjoy both of them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, especially for the last. We have another one, please, but very short. It seems to me that...
We have 5 minutes more.
Thank you very much. My name is Nadia Boreko. I represent Foreign Policy Council Ukrainian Prism, Ukraine. I find it very interesting that today, now actually, we have two parallel sessions on security and minorities. However, I believe that these issues are very much interlinked. And my question will be to Professor Wolf. How do you assess the impact of minorities on the regional security, moving a bit further than the EU to its eastern vicinity, mainly to its neighborhood, especially taking into account that some particular actor can speculate on minority issues to justify the conflicts? And here I refer to the annexed Crimea and the conflict in Donbas. And how would the EU, how could the EU enhance actually the security in the neighborhood, referring to this problematic issue? Thank you.
Well, the question wasn't too long, but the answer might be. So. I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things where I think you... Is it on? Okay. It's one of those things where, on the one hand, it's very easy to see the solution, and on the other hand, it's 100% obvious to me that the solution will not be implemented, because there are 1,000 other considerations that people have. I mean... One of the things, if I understood the translation correctly, I also wanted to say, I mean, it's dangerous to always refer to Russia as the bad actor. It's Russian elites. I mean, I would argue it's Putin in particular. I mean, if you go back in the history, I mean, a lot of the trouble that we have now started in 1999, and that was when Putin, whatever he became, I think, prime minister under Yeltsin first. So, I mean... We also have, I mean, and I'm not really a sort of critical discourse analyst, linguist, anything like that. And I think also we have to watch our own language. I mean, if we say it's Russia that does that, no, it's not. I mean, it's a particularly, and don't quote me on this, evil elite at the moment that has whatever grand designs for itself and its country. But not for a minute do I believe that a majority of Russians really necessarily care about Novorossiya and getting Crimea back and all of those things. So I think to be more precise on your question, I mean, it's also the EU is partly at fault here. For not realizing that sort of what was coming out of the Kremlin, but partly also it plays a not too dissimilar game from Russia. I mean, it's about influence seeking. It's about expanding zones of influence. I think in that way, it's really not an exaggeration to say that we are back to sort of great power or superpower politics as we have seen it in the Cold War and before the Cold War. And I think unless there is empathy, as you mentioned, not necessarily empathy with Mr. Putin himself, but empathy with a particular worldview that of course also is historically rooted and anchored. Russia always has had a problem, for right or wrong, better or worse, with sort of feeling encircled, feeling enemies at the border. If you just look at it from a geostrategic, geopolitical perspective, Ukraine is, that's potentially a massive gap in Russian defenses. So you can totally see how it's not unreasonable in the Kremlin to get worried when there is talk about Ukraine joining the EU, Ukraine joining NATO. Now that's not to say that that would necessarily be then the first step towards an invasion of Russia, regime change, whatever. But I think we have to try to understand sometimes why people do certain things. That might still lead us to say, well, what Putin does is evil, selfish, and so on and so forth. But without sort of trying to understand where another position might come from, it all becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. I'm not an apologist for Putin or current policy in the Kremlin, but I think it's always too easy, and looking back, if you want, all the way to 1914 and the beginning of the First World War, if you only find fault with the other side and do not consider what impact your own actions might actually have had in triggering a particular policy on the other side, it's not rocket science to see how things then quite easily escalate and get better. So I'm not sure that was in any way helpful, but it's as much as I can do.
Thank you so much, Professor. Anyway, ending up our meeting, I would like you'd have to have in mind some words and concepts which had been put on the table by our guest speakers. Among them is respect for diversity, limits of pluralism, French versus nobiliar model, and finally, and I am referring especially to the last question and the caveat which had been taken by Professor Wolf not to be apologetic to Kremlin or etc., it's empathy, namely to try to understand the other, being minority or being a weaker part in a confrontation. If you would agree with my conclusions, I am thanking you a lot for what you have said here, and hopefully you would attend also the other panels in order to share with us your huge experience in a way in this particular field and for him concerning Romania's past. I am talking about Mr. Dorty. And for that, in the end, I would like to thank also to the audience for the patience and for the interest being shown here to our guest speaker. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And we have